to bed with you. Hey, you too.
Well, Becky, I came close to taking off for England.
What do you mean?
Well, I'll tell you about it after I've had my supper.
Did you bring me anything?
No, Israel. As a matter of fact, I did bring you something. And it's magic.
What's magic about an old cane?
Well, I got it from a magician.
A real magician?
About the greatest magician in the world. Why, he can pull lightning right out of the sky and plug it up in an old wine bottle.
Real lightning?
Or he can tell you the weather 100 miles away or make corn grow twice as fast as it ought to. And best of all, he saw to it that we got that powder and shot we went after.
And if you want your supper, you better kindle the fire for me.
Well, we don't need any kindling. Israel, let me have this magic cane.
You ain't gonna burn it.
Burn it? Oh, sir, I'm gonna use it. First, we have to say the magic words. Jemima, you say them.
What words?
Oh, you know, the one about the charm and the three geese.
Oh, that one. All right. Gentry, mintry, cutchery corn, apple seed and apple thorn, wire, briar, limber, lock, three geese in a flock. One flew east, one flew west, and one flew over the cuckoo's nest.
Presto! Well, you come right over here, son, and I'll tell you all about it while your ma's heating up my supper.
Daniel Boone was a man, yes, a big man, with an eye like an eagle and as tall as a mountain. Daniel Boone was a man, yes, a big man. To make all Americans free. From the coonskin cap on the top of old Dan to the heel of his rawhide shoe, the rippin'est, roarin'est, fightin'est man the frontier ever knew. What a boom, what a doer, what a dream come a truer. What a boom, what a doer, what a dream come a truer was he.
Late at night, we passed this old house without paying much attention. And right then, we had no idea what was going on inside.
And that's the other flower pot. Now, have you the honey there, Mary?
Right here, Dr. Franklin.
You. Good. There we are. Let's pour some on there. Now, Mary, do you have our little friendly ant handy?
Right.
Thank you. Good. Now, the purpose of this experiment is to discover whether or not ants have a way of communicating with one another. So we'll let this little fellow loose on this flower pot containing the honey. Ooh. Ah, there he goes. Now, the other flower pot over there will stay just as it is, without any ant.
Well, are you saying, Dr. Franklin, that as soon as that ant discovers the honey, he's going to dash home and tell all the other ants about it?
No, Clara, but if in a few hours from now, pot number one is full of ants while there is still no ants in pot number two, we'll have reason to suspect that our ant did exactly what you just did. And if the same experiment should lead always to the same result, then we can be fairly certain that ants have a way of communicating with each other. Ah, how's that, Mary? Did that satisfy your request for a scientific experiment?
It's really very simple, isn't it?
And in the meantime, my house will be full of ants.
Oh, if that should happen, all we have to do is hang the pot plant outside, and they'll all disappear again. Then we'll have invented a new way to rid houses of ants.
Oh, Mary, dear, I think it's time you were off to bed.
Yes, Mother. Good night, Dr. Franklin.
And leave your window open, as I told you. Fresh air prevents cold.
Oh, well, now that I'm rid of my daughter's competition, may I enjoy your company until Monsieur Penny comes for you?
You know, Clara, I was thinking, why should I go to France when America holds such delight? Come, my dear, let's retire to the drawing room, and I promise you, in what time remains, I'll be most unscientific.
Here for more than an hour.
I'm sorry, Richard, but Mother has a guest. He came unexpectedly.
Yes, I saw the carriage driver. Will he be staying long?
Oh, no, he's leaving tonight for France. Someone's coming for him.
France? Who is he?
Just an old friend of Mother's. A doctor.
A doctor? What kind of doctor?
Richard, I really must get back. Mother thinks I've gone to my room. Good night, Richard.
Admiral Clydesdale at once. Inform him that I have good reason to believe that Benjamin Franklin is a guest in this house.
Benjamin Franklin? That would be quite a catch, sir.
Then there's someone else we might catch first, Private. The Lord Admiral will be most pleased.
Sir?
One never advances in the King's army by sitting on one's hands, Private. Come on.
Must be the wrong road. If there's a town around here, we should be able to see a light.
The trouble with roads, Daniel, they confuse the instincts. We may not admit this in Kentucky, but the truth is, we're lost. Maybe not. Ho! Do that! Ho! Much help? Find a place in bed down.
Mindful, sir. I was first in my class in swordsmanship.
Lieutenant, you're a fool. If you knew that the Frenchman had a rendezvous with Franklin at this house, why didn't you let him get here? He would have led us to the French ship.
Because, my lord, if we captured him here, Mrs. Merivale's daughter would know I'd used the information she gave me.
In the meantime, we don't know where the ship is anchored, and we don't know whether the Frenchman is alive or dead.
Alive, my lord. We only stunned.
Oh, I've taken the precaution of having the house surrounded. If the Frenchman's friends realize that this is his destination, they may bring him to us. If so, let them enter unmolested.
Yes, my lord.
When I have them all in the trap, I'll close it. Be on the lookout for my signal. I'll be inside, paying a call on the charming widow. Drive on.
A man as busy as you are ever find time to learn to play the violin?
By starting very young, when I was 54, and practicing while waiting for other men to keep appointments.
Yes, you certainly should have been here a long time ago. But I don't see how anything could have gone wrong. All the servants had been smacked for the night, and only the three of us knew that he was coming. Only you and I know why.
There, just in time to stop your worrying and end my pleasure. Let him in. And we'll have a last toast of your fine Madeira.
You shall have 3 dozen bottles to take with you to ward off the Atlantic chill. My Lord Clydesdale.
Good evening, Clara. I got to thinking of you here alone on this dark night, and I said to myself, duty be hanged. I'll drop anchor, and I'll spend an hour or two with my old friend, Clara. But you don't seem too happy to see me.
Well, of course, I'm pleased, but it's so late and I was about to retire. Please, my lord, some other night. I'm really very tired.
Nonsense. You look as fresh as an English primrose. In any case, I won't be too long. Or can it be that you already have company? Benjamin Franklin. You are perhaps the last person I hoped to find here.
If I may return the compliment, Lord Clydesdale, you are the last person I would hope to find there. We last met, I believe, in the halls of your British Parliament.
Apparently you gentlemen know each other.
Yes. Several years ago in London, I explained to Lord Clydesdale that one of the easiest methods whereby a great empire could lose its colonies is that of sending its navy among them to blockade their harbors and rivers while the crew steals all the chickens and pigs along the way. I believe Lord Clydesdale, as Admiral of the Fleet, is now putting my theory to the test. I regret such flattery.
It is not pigs we're after, Dr. Franklin. Only rebels. Though at times I must confess it's difficult to tell them apart. I offer free transportation to England to any I find.
Lord Clydesdale, now that you see that I am engaged for the evening, don't you think it would be better for you to leave?
I'm surprised, Clara, and disappointed. Your late husband was a loyal subject to his king.
5 years ago, the colonies were filled with loyal subjects of the king. Things have changed, my lord.
Indeed they have changed, Clara. And all because men like Dr. Franklin have sown the seeds of rebellion and treason among you. I'll not pretend any longer, Clara. Your house is surrounded by British soldiers. Everyone in it is under arrest, including Dr. Franklin.
Then I see no need for delay. I'm sure you have your flagship waiting. Why not start my journey for England at once?
You seem very anxious to lead me away. Oh, no, Dr. Franklin. I need the evidence to hang you first.
Somewhere out on the bay is a French ship. I'm reliably informed that you are expecting a French agent whose assignment is to take you aboard.
So if you don't mind, I'll stay here a while and catch all my fish in one net.
Well, then, we might as well enjoy a glass of Mrs. Merivale's 68 vintage. A very fine Madeira, if I must say so. Clara? Admiral? I think you'll find it gives one an excellent appetite for fish.
Well, there's the house. I have a feeling about that house, Daniel. One of us should remain outside. You're right. I can manage him.
Admiral's orders. Let them get inside the house.
You're quite right, Franklin.
An excellent Madeira.
I don't know when I've tasted better.
I'm glad you enjoyed it. It was smuggled through your blockade.
Talking about this man, I don't think he's interested in escape. He's had an accident.
I'm sorry they were waiting for me.
Oh, take him upstairs,
please. One moment. I'll take charge of this man.
Lord Clydesdale, have you lost all sense of humanity? This man needs help. Come with me, Mr.
Boone.
Mr. Boone.
Daniel Boone. Would you mind telling me what this man is doing here, Doctor?
I'm sure I don't know.
With Boonesboro, the only American fort west of the Appalachians, isn't it possible that he has come to see you to receive instructions for spreading this cancerous rebellion to the frontier?
The infection of liberty will spread without any instructions from me, my lord.
In here.
Your father's. Now, Mary, hurry down to the ice house and fetch me some ice to make a pack. I don't think the soldiers will stop you.
Soldiers?
Somehow the British learned that Monsieur Penet was coming here tonight. Hurry, dear, hurry.
These letters are very important.
Clara, to answer your question, I have not lost my humanity. But neither do I intend to lose any evidence of treason.
No, monsieur!
Will you break the seal of the King of France?
Under the present circumstances, yes. You're under arrest, Mr. Boone. remain in this room. If you make any attempt to leave the house, you'll be shot.
I don't know much about what's going on here. Who he is or what he's doing here, but what I do know is this is addressed to Benjamin Franklin. You are Benjamin Franklin.
Yes, Mr. Boone.
Just so that you can all stop pretending ignorance, I am Admiral Lord Clydesdale. That man on the bed there is a French agent put ashore by a French ship which is at the moment hiding in these waters. I have every reason to believe that amongst those papers is a contract for the shipment of arms to those colonists who have rebelled against their king, amongst whom Dr. Franklin has the dubious honor of being one of the most conspicuous. They will all hang. And by your presence here, you will also hang. I advise you to hand over those papers at once.
The Admiral means precisely what he says. We're all his prisoners.
I expect a man likes to read his own mail before anyone else does.
You make it necessary for me to place you under physical restraint.
I wouldn't call out just yet if I were you. I've been in this house barely 5 minutes. You've told me I'll be shot if I leave and hanged if I don't. Doesn't leave me much choice, does it? Move away from that window.
You realize, of course, that you have just signed your death warrant.
That's the third time you've told me I'm going to die. Suppose we find a quiet place and have a little talk. Might be I can persuade you to change your mind and call off your soldiers. Straight ahead and down those stairs.
Yes, although at the moment I feel slightly superfluous. Monsieur Franklin!
Please, monsieur, lie still. You could be of no use to anyone the way you are.
Have the ice you wanted, Mother?
Good. Now lie back, monsieur. This will make you feel better.
Of you offering to help, Daniel, but I'm afraid I'm far too old to go running about at night. Besides, I'd need Monsieur Penet to help find the French ship, and I'm afraid he's presently in no condition to travel. It ought to be plain to you now, Clydesdale, that Mr. Boone's part in this is sheer accident. So why not promise to let him leave peaceably, and I'll promise to give you no trouble whatsoever.
You mean you'd let him haul you off to England to hang?
I have a vast number of friends in England, and should they see me hang, it could only be a victory for the colonies. So give us your word, Admiral. You have mine.
I'm not sure that's a bargain I'd care to make.
Nonetheless, I'll make it. Peaceably was the key word, however. So put away your rifle. I'll give you safe conduct.
Afraid I can't do that. We'll just have to figure something else out, Dr. Franklin.
Take his gun and that packet.
I should have made the bargain when it was offered.
It would not have made any difference, Mr. Boone. A bargain made under duress is no bargain. You threatened the life of a British officer, and for that you'll hang.
That's the fourth time.
Not yet returned.
I've been hearing about you for several years, Daniel, but I also have the distinct impression that we've met somewhere before.
Yes, sir, we have. But I'm surprised you remember. I was just 21.
Of course, General Braddock's army.
Braddock's army. I picked up a circular somewhere that said they'd pay 2 shillings a day for a man and a pack horse. I ended up transporting army supplies.
Ah, those British. I tried explaining to General Braddock some of the peculiar hazards of Indian fighting, but he paid no attention. I remember his exact words. These savages may indeed be a formidable enemy to your Nor-American militia, but upon the troops, regular and disciplined troops, sir, it's impossible that they should create any impression. You must have been there at the defeat.
Yes, sir, I was. You should have seen them run. Fastest army since creation.
As I recall, they ran right back through Philadelphia. All the way to the Atlantic Ocean.
Dr. Franklin, enough of this ludicrous discourse on the tactics of the British Army. I think it's high time that we discovered the full extent of your treason.
Of having an English father.
My father was English, too.
Well, you see, we've discovered something in common already.
So you see, in a way, I'm really responsible for what happened. I think I know now just what Lieutenant Fergus's interest in me has been. Information.
Then perhaps you'd like to help Dr. Franklin and Monsieur Fournier to escape from this place.
Indeed, I would. Anything.
Here.
things at Fort Boonesboro now?
We're doing our best, but it's hard to hang on without ammunition.
Oh.
That's what we're doing so far from home. Tried to get powder in Salem, but the British had impounded all of it. So we came on here.
We, Mr. Boone?
That's right, my lord. When I first saw him on the road, there was another man with him. Someone disguised as an Indian.
You wait till now to tell me.
If Fergus saw me on the road, then he's one of the two men who attacked Panay. That information any interest to you, Dr. Franklin?
Why, yes. I'll include it in my report to the Court of France. King Louis, I believe, will object strenuously to British officials trying to assassinate his agents.
You will not be making any report to the King of France, Dr. Franklin. Kindly escort Mr. Boone upstairs and keep him under close arrest with Monsieur Penny. On your feet.
Talk to you later, Dr. Franklin.
Yes, from an English scaffold. So, Fergus, tell your men to search the grounds for a man disguised as an Indian.
Yes, my lord.
Private.
Aye, sir.
I seem to have forgotten your name.
Dunsmore, sir.
Take this man's rifle, Dunsmore, and get outside.
Aye.
Tell the other men to be on the alert for a man disguised as an Indian.
All right, sir.
Keep moving.
Perhaps I'll read some of your letters to you, Dr. Franklin, to acquaint you with your own treachery.
That will be most courteous of you.
The Honorable Benjamin Franklin. Dear friend and colleague, you will be delighted to hear that Europe's young musical genius, Wolfgang Mozart, has recently composed a prelude especially arranged for that most interesting instrument of your own invention that you left with us on your last visit. A copy of the music is enclosed.
The instrument to which my friend refers is based on this principle, Admiral. With a sufficient number of different sized glasses to complete the diatonic scale and arranged so that several tones may be played simultaneously. Here, let me demonstrate for you. Perhaps its inventor deserves hanging.
Aren't you Lieutenant Fergus?
Yes, my lady.
My daughter Mary has told me about you. I believe you were once in this house as a guest.
Yes, indeed I was, my lady.
I admire the way that you repay our hospitality.
But, my lady, I...
Keep them both here until we're ordered to leave.
I believe, my friend, I'm indebted to you for saving my life.
Forget the debt. I saved you on the highway just so you can hang in England. And by bringing you to this house, I'm afraid Dr. Franklin will hang alongside of you.
And yourself too, monsieur.
As you French say, c'est la guerre.
Hello, Mary.
I don't think we have anything to say to each other, Lieutenant.
But, Mary, please try to understand. I was only doing my duty.
And does your duty include making love to young ladies, Lieutenant? It serves you right for thinking I was that kind of a girl. And I hope you catch cold.
The French Royal Society of Science was most interested in your paper regarding the temperature and speed of the Gulf Stream.
Ah, they received the paper then. I do hope, Clydesdale, that as we cross the Atlantic, you'll let me continue my Gulf Stream investigations. The results should be most beneficial to a seafaring nation such as England.
Mastodon bones. Marsh gas.
Ah. You will be interested in knowing, Dr. Franklin, that because of the rebellious position you have taken, King George III has had all of your lightning rods removed from Windsor Palace.
Good. I've been protecting him from the wrath of heaven long enough. Did you really believe, Clydesdale, that we would be foolish enough to commit ourselves to any treasonable transactions in writing? The people of this country have authorized me to act for them in their best interests. And the only document I intended taking with me to France is this. You may read it. The Proceedings of the Second Continental Congress. There are many copies of it, and although you may destroy this one, and me along with it, it'll still find its way to the courts and people of all the countries in Europe. And when it is read, and when men everywhere know that Americans are determined to die rather than yield a single step to tyranny. Do you think we'll have to beg for help? It'll come of its own accord, in the form of monies and arms and volunteers who are themselves ready to die for the cause of freedom.
Located the French sloop off of McCadden's Cove. If we act now, it's ours. Notify the lieutenant.
For years, I have labored to preserve from breaking that fine china vase, the British Empire. But I know that once it is broken, the separate parts will never have the strength of the whole. Nor will a perfect reunion ever be possible. It's still not too late. Grant us only the liberties that you demand for yourselves. And there's no limit to what England and America united as a single nation can achieve.
Milord.
Yes, Lieutenant.
The French sloop has been located, sir. Off McCadden's Cove and ready to sail.
I, too, wish to preserve the British Empire, Dr. Franklin, by the only method certain to succeed, and that is to bring to justice those rebels like yourself who would destroy it. Lieutenant. Get the other prisoners downstairs. Put them aboard my flagship at once. We'll attack the sloop.
An act of war, Lord Clydesdale?
A French ship in these waters is war, Dr. Franklin. Particularly one waiting to take you to France.
Mary, but I don't think Lord Clydesdale would want me to keep him waiting any longer.
I have been kept waiting so long, another minute won't make any difference. I would be fascinated to witness this experiment.
In there.
What is in there, Doctor?
Ants?
Ants! Take him away. Ants.
Goodbye, Clara.
You know, you better see the horses are saddled and ready. My turn to try to set us free, Doctor.
How?
Something of a magician?
Well, I have perpetrated a few hoaxes in my time.
Try to conjure up a little excitement.
I think I understand what you mean. an advertisement.
Mm-hmm. It's contemptible, using an innocent young girl as an informer.
Nothing that helps to preserve the empire is contemptible.
Be grateful that I am not taking you to England with me.
Come on, hurry it up.
I say, Daniel, I think our advertisement is approaching.
Lordship Dunsmore, get them in the carriage.
Wrong way, sir. All right, sir. Into the carriage with you. Up you go. Come on now. Move along now. All right, big fella. In you go.
Mount up!
Great heavens, man. What's the matter with your torch?
I don't see anything wrong with it.
Yes, there is. See how it burns. Get rid of it, man. It's going to be a
for exercise every day, Daniel.
Let's go.
But probably intact, my lord. An astute deduction, Lieutenant.
They're not here, my lord. And they obviously got out somewhere back down the road. This cove you talked about. Can you lead me to it?
Yes, my lord.
One of them's still here, my lord. He's escaping. After him! Lieutenant Fergus! Come back!
Lieutenant. Yes, my lord. He's not important. It's the others we're after.
Yes, my lord. My lord, my horse. How am I going to get back?
You might try walking, Lieutenant.
I'll get the line.
Well, I suppose this is goodbye, Daniel.
Yes, sir, and you better hurry along.
About that ammunition that you needed.
Go and see Captain Wainwright at the garrison at Norfolk and show him this and tell him that I authorized the requisition. I'm sure you'll have no trouble.
Yes, sir, I'll do that. Thank you.
Thank you, Daniel. And good luck to you.
Merci, monsieur.
Patriot means the birth of a martyr. I don't want that on my shoulders.
Then what shall we do, my lord?
What can we do? Except perhaps to ask Providence to send us a storm.
I see that you made it. At the expense of a rather embarrassed young British officer. Side, isn't it? Quiet. $779.
This one? But how'd you do it, Dr. Franklin? How'd you do it?
There's only one thing wrong with giving away magic secrets.
What's that?
Then it isn't magic anymore.
It is when I show it to somebody else.
Mm-hmm. A good point. Very well, then. Now, you see this cane here? I had it made a few years ago when I was studying the effect oil has on the surface of water. And I used to amaze my friends by waving it over some babbling brook and making all the waves disappear.
How do you do that?
Well, the cane is hollow and filled with oil. And all I have to do is press this little hand pump here, and the oil sprays out the end. I never used it on anything but water until tonight.
Gosh, and then you remembered oil would burn?
Right. So now that you know the secret, you might as well have the cane. Look, the fire is getting low again. Try it out.
Needles and pins... When a man marries, his troubles begin. Presto!
Israel? Wouldn't you know he'd fall asleep just when we get to the best part of the story?
I'm not asleep. I heard every word. Where is he?
Where's who?
Benjamin Franklin. He was right here.
Oh, Israel, what in the world are you talking about?
Oh, he's been dreaming again.
Well, what did he do?
He gave me his cane and showed me how it worked.
And then?
And then he disappeared. Dr. Franklin? Wow, he is a magician.
It's way past your bedtime. Boy, come on. You too, Jemima.
What a boom, what a doer, what a dream come a truer. What a boom, what a doer, what a...